Now the first session after the evaluation function is going to start now from Professor Pradeep Majumdar sir. He is currently serving as a professor in the Department of Civil Engineering and as a chairman interdisciplinary center for water research. And also he is holding the position of associate faculty position in Center for Earth Sciences at IISc Bangalore, and his area of specialization in water resources mainly focus on climate change impact on hydrology, water resources, statistical downscaling of GCM outputs, urban flooding planning and operation of large scale water resource systems, and uncertainty modeling. His research recent contributions which includes detection and attribution of hydrologic change, development of downscaling modeling and quantification, and reduction of uncertainty in climate change impact assessment. And also he served as a chairman of water resource management section of International Association for Hydro Environment Engineering and Research. He is also a reviewer for assessment report of 5 of IPCC. Professor Majumdar is a recipient of Alexander I Humboldt Medal of the European Geoscience Union, the Distinguished Visiting Fellowship of the Royal Academy of Engineering, UK, and CSIR and NGRI, AHI Indian National Hydrology Lecture Award. He is a member of editorial board of journal Advances in Water Resources, and he has also served as a member of editorial board of the Journal of Water International, and he has been a member of several state and national committee dealing with urban flooding and even operation and environmental aspects of water resources in India. And his teaching interest, which mainly includes of stochastic hydrology, water resource system, surface water hydrology and urban hydrology. His areas of professional consultancy includes the urban stormwater drainage, flood management, river basin planning, reservoir operation, lift irrigation, hydropower development and impact assessment of water resource projects. He is a J.C. Bose National Fellow and is a Fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineers, Indian Academy of Science and Indian National Science Academy. If I start his biodata to read, it may take more than 1 hour, and his links are already provided to the all the participants, and for in more detail to go through that, you can use the link and see the Majumdar sir biodata. Please go through that. I think many of the participants already they have seen. And now I welcome our Professor Majumdar sir to give the address lecture on urban floods on emerging challenges. Please sir, you can start your presentation sir, please.
Thank you very much Dr. Jyoti Prakash for that very elaborate introduction. I did not expect this, so sorry to the participants for such an elaborate introduction. It is a privilege for me to be part of this workshop, and it was wonderful listening to our old colleague and friend Professor VP Singh. So thank you very much JB Pant University, Professor Prasad as well as Dr. Jyoti Prakash for this opportunity. So let me try sharing my screen. I hope it works. So can you, Dr. Jyoti, can you confirm that it is visible?
Yeah, it's visible, sir. It's visible.
Okay.
The slide shows.
Yeah. So I'm trying to go to the full screen mode.
Okay.
All right. So thank you very much, and welcome to the participants. Some of the participants would have been aware of this lecture already, because I see that some of them had attended our monsoon schools, and also some of them may be our students. So pardon me if there is some significant repetition in what I'm talking about. So essentially, I'll take off from where Professor V.P. Singh left, that there have been significant changes, advancements in technology. For example, you know, our communication technology has improved significantly. The satellite technologies have improved, and also the GIS, remote sensing, and the sensor technologies to measure anything at a very high spatial as well as temporal resolution. These have increased significantly by leaps and bounds over the last few decades. However, our problems on the ground remain the same. And in fact, they are getting aggravated year after year, especially the floods. These are the biggest and severest natural disasters we face year after year. So the question that we need to ask is, while on one side there is a significant technological advancement, but on the other side, we are unable to address these problems. So what can we do to look at use of technologies to start mitigating the effects of floods? Of course, we cannot avoid the floods, but can we mitigate the impacts of floods on the common person? Now, these images are very common to us. I have not put the year there, Hyderabad floods. Any year, these will be the common scenes that we see. Similarly, Bangalore floods, year after year, we see this. And these days, this kind of situation is propagating to other cities also. For example, Baroda gets flooded, Nasik last year got flooded, and so on. So any urban area we are looking at, there is a significant flooding that happens year after year. But there are some events that stand out.
Sir, slides are not changing.
Oh, not moving?
Yeah.
Are you sure you have made me presenter? Because I have gone through to already 4 slides.
No.
Are you seeing the first slide now?
No.
What are you seeing?
I think still you are not presented your You unshare it and share it, sir, again.
Okay, let me try. You know, this Google is always a problem for me.
Through window. Huh?
Are you seeing now?
Yeah. Now it's coming up.
No problem. You must alert me.
Yeah.
So is it on the full screen mode?
No, not yet.
Are you seeing the second slide?
No.
First slide only, sir.
Okay. So let me try again. So I am using the present now mode.
Present now.
Windows.
Yeah, I have gone to window.
Yes, sir. Share.
And I'm opening this file.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
Are you seeing now?
No, sir.
No.
Not yet.
Other option is you can just go to first one. Share my screen.
What is this?
Same thing. There is a present now. Your entire screen, you can just do it, sir. Instead of second one, you just enter first one.
Oh, I see. Okay. Let me see.
You unshare it.
So I'm going to share now, correct?
Yeah, your entire
screen. And then entire screen.
Yeah.
then I'll open the file.
Huh.
Are you seeing the file?
No.
See, we use Zoom and Teams. There is no problem. Okay, let me start all over again. I unnecessarily talked a lot. So maybe, you know, I'll tell you what I'm doing. I'll first open the file.
Okay,
on the desktop.
Yeah.
The file is open now.
Okay, fine.
Now I'm going to Google Meet.
Yeah.
I'm saying present now.
Present now. You are entered.
And I'm going to window. And that window is visible now. So I'll say share. Are you seeing?
Window is visible.
No, are you seeing the file?
Yeah. It is fine. This much is fine anyhow.
Okay, I am going to second slide now. Can you see the second slide?
Move it.
No.
Are you seeing the second slide?
No, sir.
No.
It's not moving actually.
Otherwise, email it. You just send a mail. I will send
it. Yeah, I don't mind doing that, but I don't know why it should not work. Maybe I'll try to join again. I'm sorry for this inconvenience.
Yeah.
I'll try to join again.
Otherwise, you can say present your entire screen. Sir, your audio is off.
Yeah, I sent it to you by email now.
Okay.
Anyway, I'll try again. I'm sorry for this inconvenience.
Sir, that entire screen you can just do it. Present your entire screen.
Okay. But I'm seeing only myself there when I say present entire screen. Now I'll open, is it?
Let it be, you can present.
Are you able to see now?
No.
No, I don't think entire screen will work. It will only be this one.
Windows you can use.
I have sent you the file, Mr. Prasad.
Which
I am doing everything right here. I am able to see the slide.
Okay.
Does it go to the second slide now?
No. Now it's
okay. But does it go to third one now?
No.
Hyderabad floods, are you seeing?
No. Second one.
Oh, no, that won't help. Chennai floods 2015, are you seeing?
No, second slide we are seeing, sir.
Only second slide.
That won't help. Okay. All right. So, Professor Prasad, you can download the file and I will start talking. Anyway, I don't want to waste too much of time. So while the file is getting ready, let me start talking.
Sir, you sent the file?
I have sent it to your Gmail. Because the file size is very high, it has sent it through that Dropbox or whatever. Okay, there is a suggestion I can go to. I can create a PDF. I think that's a good idea. So let me convert it into PDF.
It's fine. It's fine.
But Professor Prasad, just for your comfort, I'll assure you that this happens to me always without fail. Okay. When you call me for presenting anything, it has to happen. So don't worry too much about it. And I'll try to finish it as per the schedule. Okay, so I have converted into PDF. Let me see if it works. Okay, this is the last attempt I'll make, otherwise you present it, okay? So are you seeing it now?
Yeah, it's still visible.
You're seeing the first slide, right?
First slide.
Okay, are you seeing the second slide?
Yeah.
This is a PDF. So I thank Dr. Archana Kumar who made this suggestion. All right, let me start again. So from where Professor VP Singh left, let me restart. So as he said, there has been a significant technological advancement on communication, on satellite remote sensing, and also sensor technologies, etc. But the ground level problems have still remained the same. And especially the floods, which we face year after year. And I am talking about cities such as Hyderabad, Bangalore, etc. We see such situations every year. In fact, there is a joke going around that earlier we used to say that whoever owns a car is a rich person. Now you need to own a boat in the city to be called a rich person. So especially Chennai floods of 2015, you know, you must remember there are some significant common features among all these floods that we are seeing year after year. One is very high level of rainfall, high intensity of rainfall, and high intensity of rainfall occurring consecutive days, day after day after day, very high intensity of rainfall. For example, this Chennai floods, you know, why we keep on referring to this is that about 400 people died in the city and surrounding areas, 2.3 million houses inundated, and there is a huge industrial loss. For example, that TVS Motors, etc., which were located in the city, they got completely inundated, and you can imagine that when such industries get inundated, the losses will be irrecoverable. And apart from the rainfall, extremely high releases, about 29,000 cubic feet per second of releases came into the city from the upstream reservoirs exactly when the city was completely flooded. And these caused enormous losses. Then we had Kashmir floods. Of course, Kashmir floods were riverine floods, but they inundated cities, Srinagar city, etc. They inundated significantly. Again, the same symptoms, very high rainfall, above 100 millimeters per day between 4th to 6th September. This is, I'm talking about 2014. And even 2021, we had floods, 2020, we had floods, and so on. So here in the Kashmir floods, banks of river Zelem, Chenab, Tawi, and many other streams were burst. And that is what caused significant levels of flooding. So let us focus on urbanization first. Why urban floods have become important? Professor Prasad, can you confirm that you can see the mouse moving?
Yes, sir, moving.
It's moving.
All right. So you look at two catchments like this. One is a pristine catchment where there is no development and it is in a natural surrounding. Another is a completely urbanized catchment. The same intensity and duration of rainfall occurring on a natural catchment will produce a smoother response like this, where there is enough time for the rainfall to evaporate as well as infiltrate, and even the runoff that takes place because of the resistance will be very smooth and slow. Whereas you look at the urban situation like this, urban watershed, any rainfall that happens here will immediately convert itself into runoff because there is no scope for it to infiltrate because of the impervious layers that we have constructed here, as well as there is no time for it to evaporate. So most of the rainfall that falls on such watersheds will convert immediately into runoff. As a result, if you look at what we call as hydrographs, the flow versus time graphs, if you look at the urban hydrograph for the same level of rainfall, the peak occurs much faster if you are looking at some location, common location here, and assuming that the area, etc., is the same at common point. If you are looking at, the time to peak will be much, much shorter in the urban areas. The peak volume itself will be very large, peak discharge will be very large, and the total runoff for the same duration of the rainfall will be much, much higher. And there are other factors such as base flow gets affected, etc., if you are looking at the annual scales. But these three prominent symptoms of urbanization, namely that the time to peak is much, much shorter, the peak discharge will be much higher, and the total runoff will be much higher, these cause an enormous challenge in managing urban floods. So how do we go about addressing these problems? As you can see, the urban floods are caused by mainly two reasons. One is a very high intensity of rainfall. The second is how the hydrology responds, how the basin responds to such high intensity of rainfall. So we need to look at both these aspects. What is happening in the atmosphere in terms of the intensity of rainfall, and what is happening on the city itself in terms of the land use patterns and in terms of the development that has taken place, in terms of the drainage system that we have created and so on. So both these aspects become extremely important. So when we look at the intensities of rainfall, the intensities are known to be increasing. In fact, in India, most of the cities that we study over the past, if you simply look at the short duration, high intensity rainfall, these are known to be increasing. These are seen to be increasing from the data itself. But there may be many reasons because of which these intensities are increasing. One is the urban heat island effect, UHI is called. What happens is that we create such clusters of city where there is a huge heat capture that happens here. And this capture of heat happens because of several reasons. For example, the materials of construction that we use, concrete, asphalt, and so on. Then there is a lack of vegetation. Typically, these are all the so-called concrete jungles. And therefore, there is a lack of evapotranspiration to effect cooling. Then there is also waste energy, for example, from air conditioners, cooling systems, etc. Then there is air pollution because of traffic and other reasons. Then there are also tall buildings which also block the surface heat from radiating into the cool sky, because of which this becomes a trap for the heat. Typically, if you analyze an urban area with respect to the surrounding areas, the temperatures are always higher here. And because of this urban heat island effect, it has been shown through several studies that the intensities of the rainfall, especially the convective rainfall, increase as you go from one end to the other end. And also now they have shown that not only just longitudinally, but also in the surrounding regions like this, the rainfall intensities keep on increasing because of the urban heat island. Then there are also climate change issues, as Professor V.P. Singh also touched, because of which rainfall intensity increases. Now, this is the first ideology course 101, pardon me for that, but this background is necessary. So if you have a rainfall intensity, as I said, again, we'll compare a reasonably pristine watershed like this and a completely developed watershed like this. If you are looking at this corner now and the rainfall intensity happens, for the rainfall to travel from one end of the watershed to this end of the watershed, where the entire catchment will be contributing. So at that time, where it travels from the farthest end to this end, the entire catchment will be contributing to the runoff at this location. That is called as the time of concentration. As you can see, the time of concentration in developed areas like this will be much, much smaller compared to the time of concentration at this location. Now, this becomes an important parameter when we look at the designs of urban stormwater drainage and so on. So what do we do? This is just again a brief background before I go into the research part. So if you have a catchment, let us say that you have a catchment like this, and you are, imagine that this is a large area in a city, for example, IIT area in Delhi or something, where there is a change in the land use pattern even within that particular watershed. And therefore, this watershed, we divide it into several smaller watersheds with respect to the change in the land use pattern, its digital elevation maps, etc. That means terrain conditions and so on. Like this, we divide the watershed into several smaller watersheds. And if the intensity, I is the intensity here, intensity is kept the same. Actually, now we vary the intensity also, but for the time being, you take the intensity to be the same. Then the flow, we need to estimate the flow. This is called as a rational formula. The flow peak we estimate based on, you imagine if it is completely developed and there is not a single drop of water that is lost either to evaporation or to infiltration, then all of that should come as outflow there in this particular sub watershed. And that should have been I into A simply. That is intensity into area. This will give you meter cube per second. But because there are obstructions to flow, as well as because of the land use pattern, there will be some reduction in the flow, and that is given by this runoff coefficient. Now, as you can see, runoff coefficient will depend on soil conditions and rainfall intensity itself. It depends on the degree of soil compaction, vegetation, ground slope, depression storage, etc. So this is anyway hydrology 101 course. I don't want to spend too much time on that, but you can see, for example, this is from the Ventecho book. For different types of surface coverage, these are the runoff coefficients. And these are called as the return periods. That is, once in about how many years that particular intensity is likely to return. For example, when I say 5 years, once in about 5 years, that intensity is likely to recur. If you are talking about 5 year return period and asphaltic, it will be 0.77. which means that about 77% of the rainfall gets converted into runoff. So as you can go down here, you have good grass cover with 75% of the areas, etc. You can look at very low runoff coefficients. Now this becomes important because we will be talking then about low impact development. That means wherever possible, of course we cannot avoid the construction, but wherever possible, can we have low impact runoff coefficients? Now that aspect I will touch upon later. Then once we do that, let's say we are talking still about this particular watershed. And if it is a pristine watershed where you want to develop afresh, for example, a education campus you are developing, a big campus such as IIT or IISc, etc. you are developing, then you have enough flexibility of putting the drainage systems. So you identify the outlets based on the natural drainage system, natural drainage that exists in terms of the elevations, etc., and the land use. Once you identify this, based on the your engineering aspects, you can choose some configuration of the drains. Then at every location, you need to identify the hydrograph. Now, hydrograph will depend on the time of concentration. For example, if you are looking at this particular channel, it has its own watershed here. So this watershed will have a intensity of rainfall. And typically, if you take the intensity to be constant, it doesn't matter. As long as the watershed is small, then it will have time of concentration. As I said, if that particular intensity is happening, by the time it reaches this particular point, the entire watershed will be contributing. That will be the time of concentration. So typically, it rises and then attains a peak flow. And then if the rainfall stops instantaneously, these are called as a design rainfall, for which we start designing these channels, and then it starts coming down. And typically we take this as TC here, TC here, TC is the time of concentration. But we also use trapezoidal hydrographs. For example, once it attains a QP, it retains its level at QP for some time and then start decreasing. Anyway, these are details. We can discuss that if there is any interest on this. Then once we have done this for each of these watersheds, what happens is this watershed is contributing its own hydrograph here. Remember, it's not just the flow. It is the distribution of the flow with respect to time, like this. Similarly, this will be contributing to this point. Remember here, we should not be simply adding what is coming here and what is coming here in terms of the peak volume. That will be too conservative a design and becomes extremely expensive. So we need to look at the time distribution of the flow, time at which this flow comes, time at which this flow comes, the time that it takes from this point to travel to this point. And that will depend on, as you can imagine, all the channel characteristics as well as the overland flow characteristics and so on. So this is what we do, and then we estimate the peak flows at each of these locations. Then to get this flow travel from one point to another point, we use the shallow water equations or the St. Venant's equations, which are simply continuity and momentum equations, right? Then we have numerical solutions, and typically we use the routing models. These are HEC-1 and SWMM are available freely. Storm CAD and PCSWIM, etc. You can purchase. Even Mike Urban, Mike Flood, etc. They do this kind of routing. So the idea here is that if you have watersheds like this, and if you know what is the peak flow, you must be able to route this through this channel network. When you do that, you will be able to see whether this channel network is adequate to carry that kind of discharge or not. And because the intensities of the rainfall are increasing, these discharges themselves are increasing. Therefore, the designs that were made earlier, maybe 10 years, 15 years, etc., will no longer be adequate for the increased discharges as well as the changed water, changed land use patterns. Because what was existing about 15 years in a particular city has significantly changed, both in terms of land use as well as in terms of the rainfall intensities. So you look at this. This is what we mean by routing. So we'll take a small watershed here, and then that has produced overland flow like this, depending on the land use, etc. And it comes to a small channel. Like this, there are several channels. So all of these channels we route. So these are depending on the channel characteristics in terms of the width, slope, and other dimensions, material, etc. You have the flow characteristics, and those we route and bring it to the sub-basin outflow. So this defines the hydrograph at this point. So for a given input hydrograph, remember hydrograph is simply the flow versus time graph. So how the flow is changing with respect to time. For a given input intensity of rainfall, then we should be able to get what is the type of outflow hydrograph that we get that can be obtained. Now, with that, then we should be able to check for an existing system, the adequacy of the system, where the overflows are likely to happen and where the dimensions are inadequate, where the flows are much, much higher compared to what is designed for, etc. Such questions we should be able to answer. Now, I'll just briefly explain one of the projects that we have done over a period of time. In fact, this is continuing now. Right from 2014, we started this, and significant work has been done on use of technologies. So just to understand the broad overview here, I'll go into details as necessary. So as I said, we need to look at both the rainfall intensities as well as in terms as well as the land use change that is taking place on the ground. So we look at the historical data first. What is happening to short duration, high intensity rainfall? I keep emphasizing on the short duration because, as I said, the times of concentration in urban area are extremely small, and depending on the sub watershed size, etc., you take, it may be of the order of 12 minutes, 15 minutes, and so on. And therefore, those kind of intensities is what we need to look at. Remember always that when I say 12 minute intensity, it does not mean that that rainfall occurs only for 12 minutes. The rainfall may be occurring for a longer period, but there is a critical 12 minutes where the rainfall intensities are high, and therefore the network should be able to, or it should be capable of conveying that particular discharge. A good common analogy that we give to our students in the class is, Professor Prasad, is there a, are you able to hear me?
I can.
Yes, sir.
Okay. If there is any disturbance, you must alert me. Okay.
Yes, sir. Nice.
All right. So the common analogy that we give is, you imagine a restaurant, a good restaurant in a very crowded office area. And during the lunch hour, 1 to 2 or something, there is a huge crowd there. And the restaurant should be able to cater to that crowd rather than taking the average number of visitors throughout the day and then designing for that. And that is what exactly happens here. So you need to look at the high intensity rainfall, although occurring only for a short period, 15 minutes or 20 minutes, etc. And your design should be capable of handling those. That is what we look at in the historical data analysis. Then we also look at the spatial distribution itself. As we are all aware and we acknowledge that there is a significant spatial distribution of the high intensity rainfall in cities, especially. For example, if you are in Delhi and you are in IIT, just about 10 kilometers away, the rainfall intensity may be much, much different. In fact, it may not be even raining. So the rainfall intensities vary very significantly across space in urban areas. We need to look at those. And that is what we do with the historical data. Then we start looking at the future. Now, this is what is happening in the present or the past. Then what happens in the future? Can we look at the climate change impacts and see what is happening to the high intensity rainfall in the urban areas? And then we bring it down to the ground. We do the 2D overland flow modeling, because the flows of high intensity rainfall are actually contributed through the overland flow. As I said, we use the shallow water equations and then numerical analysis, etc. We estimate the flows that will be coming into the drainage system. Look at the adequacy of the stormwater drains, whether the drains as they exist now, complete with their maintenance problems, complete with the material that is used, the slope, etc. We look at the adequacy. Then we also have laboratory setups to show how quickly the floods will increase the moment there is an obstruction to flow. Because in most of the urban areas, as I will presently show, most of the urban areas, the single most important factor that we need to consider is the obstruction to flow in the drainage system. Then on the ground, we deploy several sensors, both for rainfall as well as for water levels. And then we obtain, using LIDAR, that is light detection and ranging, that kind of survey, very high resolution digital terrain maps of the order of 0.2 meters resolution. We get the digital terrain maps, and then we run our models, get the hydrometeorological data in real time. We produce the flood inundation maps to show which are the hot spots for a given intensity of rainfall, and then associated with that, we do develop all of these. So for example, flood hazard maps and management decisions, etc. Then we also look at the forecasts themselves. You know, climate change impacts, etc., are really into the future, maybe 10 years, 20 years, etc. These are planning decisions. But when we are looking at real time, we need to look at the forecasts. So can we look at the meteorological forecasts? We typically used SAC Ahmedabad forecast, but now we are developing our own forecast through WRF model. And we also define what are called as a local climate zones, LCZs. And we show through several experiments on some controlled watershed, what kind of responses that come from the hydrologic watershed. And then we use communication systems, etc. In fact, I am glad that you are listening to Dr. Shubha also of KSNDMC. All this work has been done along with KSNDMC and BBMP. So they are our government partners. And then we did a lot of outreach activities. I'm sure in the participants, some of them have attended our monsoon schools. They have become a flagship program of urban floods. Now look at this. This is the Bangalore city area. And we are fortunate enough that KSNDMC has installed a large number of TRGs, that is telemetric rain gauges. In fact, as many as 100 exist within the Bangalore area. This gives us an enormous flexibility on hydrologic analysis. Whereas many other cities will have typically, you know, IMD would have put one at the airport and one in some other state. Even if you have two, it's a luxury in many other cities. But KSNDMC has put 100 such, you know, train TRGs, that is rain gauge networks. Now, what we do is that we start looking at the past first. When we started this project, this was around 2014, we started looking at what has happened in the past events. So because we have so many rain gauges, we can get a good spatial distribution. And in terms of the qualitative description, for example, very, very light rain, heavy rainfall, etc. Now this gives you an idea of how significant is the spatial variation of high intensity rainfall. And we also go into the zones and check what kind of rainfall that has actually happened during the day. So this is at a particular time. Then what we do is we look at, this was the day on which a heavy flood occurred, 22nd, this is 26th September. Then we look at what happened in the previous 5 days. That will give us a clue on how the rainfall is developing. Remember, you know, the atmospheric scientists will give you a very good idea about how the convective rainfall progressed and so on. But as hydrologists, we simply look at what has happened on the ground over the past 5 days. Similarly, over the next 5 days, what has happened. Now, this gives us an idea of how the system is behaving and which we will use in our designs and so on. Then we start looking at what are called as the localized climate zones. Because there is a significant distribution of high intensity rainfall, we also need to look at why this is happening. First of all, intensity of rainfall with respect to the convective systems, why it is happening. Then how the ground level is responding because of the changes. For example, you may have compact high-rise buildings, compact mid-rise buildings, etc. So as you can see, in most of the cities, the central area will be completely developed, and therefore that becomes a localized climate zone one, which becomes more critical. Whereas you may have bare soil, then you have low plants, bush, scrub, all of these exist. So like this, we do the LCZ classification for the city so as to understand how the ground responds to that. Then in PPT, it will be apparent. So what happens is we have been looking at the spatial distribution of high intensity rainfall. Here the animation will not work, but I'll give you the idea. So for a period of time, for example, from 1989 to 2010, we go, and these are the city IMD stations, both within the city as well as just outside the city. There are several IMD stations, and we start looking at the annual maximum values that have occurred. You can see from 1 year to the next, these annual maximum will keep on changing For example, the maximum of the maximum may have occurred at Hebbal in 1 year. Next year it may have happened at Devanahalli. Next year it may have happened at Horohalli, and so on. So this gives us an idea of how the annual maximum rainfall is behaving both within the city as well as outside the city. That is a special variation in extreme rainfall. Then we use some advanced methodologies. For example, here we use the Bayesian model to look at the distribution of the annual maximum rainfall itself. What I talked earlier was simply the rainfall as it happened on that particular day. But we are interested in extreme rainfall. So we start producing the spatial maps of extreme rainfall. And as you can see from this particular map, which is the annual maximum, this part, the southwest part of the Bangalore city, always receives much, much higher rainfall compared to these, which is also seen from the observations. Now, these are done through statistical models and so on, extreme value distributions, etc. But even on the ground, we always see that the southwest part of Bangalore, those who are used to this area like Koramangala, etc., they always receive much, much higher intensities of rainfall. Then we look at, start looking at what is happening to long-term climate of the Bangalore city. So you need to look at the temperature, and you can see for any city of your interest, just collect the temperature as given by IMD. This is the source from IMD. The temperatures over the last about 5-6 decades continuously are increasing. Now, this is a challenge here. Between 1930 and 40, there was a dip, and this is based on the data. So why this dip happened is a major question, but that is beyond the scope of this lecture. But in general, for most of the cities, we see that there is a significant increase in the temperature. Now, although this may appear small, for example, we may be talking about from, let's say, 23.5 to 24.5 or 25. This may appear to be only 1.5 degrees change, but 1.5 degrees change over a period of about 4 decades is a very significant increase in temperature, and that will have implications on several aspects related with rainfall. Then we look at the rainfall itself. Now, as I said, the return period indicates that particular intensity of rainfall, which is likely to be equaled or exceeded once in about these many years. For example, once in about 10 years, we may expect this kind of rainfall intensity for this duration. Now, this is the duration on the x-axis. These are called as the IDF relationships, intensity, duration, frequency relationship. This is the intensity, this is the duration, and this is the frequency. 10 year is the frequency of once in 10 years it happens. As the duration decreases here, the rainfall intensities are much, much higher. I again repeat, it does not mean, for example, when I'm looking at 1 hour in a duration, it does not mean that the rainfall occurs only for 1 hour. It is the design duration that we look at. And as you can see, if you look at the entire time period between 1969 to 2012, this would have been only 67. Whereas it has increased to 103. And in many situations, we see that if you go into smaller time intervals of half an hour, 15 minutes, etc., which are important in the urban areas, the intensities have increased 100 to 150%. This is just the historical data. I'm not even going into the future. So those who are interested should do this analysis for your own city. Then we start asking the question, yes, we are aware that historically the intensities are increasing, but how are they likely to behave in future? So what are the likely changes in the intensity, duration, frequency relationships due to climate change? This is a question that we need to ask. And whenever we refer to the climate change, we have to look at the climate models. They are the most credible tools available today for addressing the climate change issues. But climate models have the limitation that they work on large spatial scales as well as on large time scales. The urban areas are very small in spatial scales, and the intensities that we are interested in are also for short durations, such as 1 hour, half an hour, etc. And therefore, we fall recourse to what is called as a downscaling on the spatial scale and disaggregation on the time scale. So now technologies are available through which, methodologies at least, methodologies are available through which we use both dynamic as well as statistical downscaling. And this is a Japanese model which they bring not only to city scale but almost to the block scale. So up to certain point you use the statistical downscaling and then use the dynamic downscaling. I'll explain what we mean by dynamic downscaling slightly later, where we use the actual atmospheric models, climate models, and then bring it down almost to block levels. So this will give you an idea of how spatially it can be brought down. Then we do for Bangalore city also the time-wise disaggregation. But this is just to give you an idea of what climate change may induce. ARI is the average recurrence interval, that is that 10-year return period, etc., that I talked about. What was happening once in about 5 years, that level of discharge may start happening once in about 2 years. This is a flood frequency, but you can relate it with rainfall also. So 10 years may start happening once in about 3.3 years. 50-year return period may become 17-year return period, which means that there is a significant increase in the frequency itself. And this causes a major challenge in urban floods. So for Bangalore, what we then do is that apart from bringing down on spatial scales, we start also looking at the time scales. As I said, we'll be interested in time scales of this order, 1 hour, half an hour, and so on. So, but the climate models are not good at these scales. So what we then do is that we take large number of models. This is about 30, 35 models and several scenarios. These are called as the RCPs, representative concentration pathway scenarios. Now, for those who are not used to this terminology, you just imagine that the climate models provide simulations of the likely future in terms of temperature, in terms of humidity, rainfall, etc. And they provide these simulations for various scenarios of typically, you know, carbon dioxide and greenhouse gas emissions, but the RCPs go much beyond just the greenhouse gas emissions. So we pick up such scenarios and use several simulations and bring it down to daily scale. And then we do what is called as a stochastic disaggregation and bring it down to hourly and sub-hourly scale. And because we have 85 simulations, we do ensemble average projections into the future. These are methodological details. Right now, don't worry about it. But right now, you look at this. This is the most critical scenario that we look at. And these are averages that are got, they are called as the ensemble averages got from so many simulations. This is the observed one, 1969 to 1998, this red curve. And this green one is for future. So let us not worry about too far into future. You just look at this, 2021 to 2050, somewhere here. So what was around 120 has become about 160 or something millimeters per hour. And this is about half an hour, 15 minutes duration, and so on. Which means that the hydrologic designs must be capable of handling these increased intensities of rainfall in future, in near future, the not far future. But there is also an interesting factor. As the duration increases, let's say we are talking about daily rainfall and so on, daily maximum rainfall, there is not too much of a difference. Also, there is not too much of an uncertainty. Here, there will be a lot of uncertainty associated with this. So we need to start looking at these increased intensities of rainfall because of climate change. Now, that is what is likely to happen in the rainfall. Now, let us look at what happens on the ground when this kind of rainfall falls. And unfortunately, in India, as indeed in many surrounding countries, the situation is quite poor on how we manage our land use. Situations like this are extremely common. So whenever there is a drain, this is supposed to be a stormwater drain with a wide cross section here, but these are all encroached upon. And then whenever there is an open space, we use it for dumping the solid waste. It's the easiest to target. As we are walking, if there is an open space, we just throw the garbage. And therefore, exactly when the stormwater drain is supposed to work at its full capacity, you get blockages like this. And therefore, it quickly builds up and then starts flooding. So this is because of the encroachment. Then you see situations like this. For example, this was supposed to be a wide drain here, but these have been built by design. It is not as if someone has encroached illegally. These lands will be allotted and therefore they start building the houses. So this is one of the major reasons. Then you have obstruction to flow due to utilities themselves. Now this is one of the drains in Bangalore city. This is a major downstream drain where it has to carry its waters up to this level. And you can imagine the amount of flow that it can carry. But by design, there will be obstructions due to utilities. There may be some water supply line going. There may be some sewage line that will be coming here. Then there may be telephone lines, etc. And of course, this kind of maintenance where these become obstructions to flow. So what we then need to do is, of course, good maintenance, etc. are important. But can we identify, as the high intensity of rainfall is happening, what is happening at several locations in the city, we must be able to capture in real time. So one is that 100 TRGs that KSNDMC has put, that is the telemetric rain gauges. But we must also look at what is happening to the water levels at critical points, how quickly it is raising. And we should also be able to identify in real time where the water is getting obstructed, where the flow is getting obstructed. Now, these we do by deploying water level sensors. So at this location, for example, this is Holimau Kere Inlet. This is a sensor that we have put. Similarly, another Goti Kere Inlet, we get this sensor. Now, this is, you imagine it's just like a camera, although we use the ultrasound technique, etc. It keeps on checking in real time. It can be as high resolution as every 1 minute and 30 seconds, etc. But we capture this or aggregate this over 2 minutes. Every 2 minutes, you know what is happening at several locations in terms of the water levels. Now, this kind of information is necessary for real-time management as well as for calibrating and validating our hydrologic models themselves. And this now, with the help of KSNDMC and BBMP, we have put it at 40 locations. So when we did this in 2014 as a pilot study, we had put 5 locations. And all of this data comes continuously to our servers. So we know at various locations, what are the water levels, how quickly they are rising, and what levels of measures that need to be taken, and so on. Then we ask the question, remember here, I talked about hydrologic models. So all of these kinds of maps are generated through hydrologic models such as SWMM, for example, stormwater management model, or the HEC models, or PCSWIM, or even the MIKE models, and so on. So for a given rainfall intensity and for the given land use patterns and the drainage patterns, we should be able to generate through those models what kind of overflows happen, what kind of flooding happens, and so on. Then we ask the question, if this kind of rainfall that happened in Surat that year happens in Bangalore, then how the Bangalore will respond? Similarly, Delhi, 144 millimeters, Chennai, 300 millimeters, Kolkata, 370 millimeters. Now, these kind of rainfalls have actually happened. And if these rainfalls actually happen in Bangalore, how Bangalore is likely to respond is the question that we ask. Now, unfortunately, all these animations don't work because this is a PDF, but you just imagine. As I said, the runoff coefficient indicates the type of development that has taken place. So if we have a very high runoff coefficient, it means that a very high level of concretization, etc., has happened. Therefore, the flooding will be much, much larger. So we show through several such exercises, as the runoff coefficient increases in the same watershed. Now, this is a lake here, and then we have a particular watershed below that. How the flooding will increase, and that flooding level is very, very significant as the runoff coefficient increases, which means that to reduce the impact of the flooding, we must start looking at the reduction in the runoff coefficient by making some adjustments in the developments that we do on the cities, in the cities. Now that we pick up this 70.75, which means 75% of the rainfall is converted into runoff, and then start applying some corrections. Let us say that we enforce 30% of rainwater harvesting. That means we are not letting out all the water into the drains or into the open areas, but 30% we hold back. Then what happens to the flood inundation as well as flood depth and so on? Unfortunately, all these animations don't work. Otherwise, you would have got a better appreciation of these pictures. So then corresponding to that, we not only put all of that rainfall over the entire city, but we choose some hot spots. And in those hot spots at different locations, if this kind of rainfall intensity happens, then how that particular hotspot will behave? This is a question that we can answer once you set the models. Then we come to the most important and most common problems, as I showed. Exactly when the drains are supposed to be, stormwater drains are supposed to be working at their full capacity, they get clogged like this. And we want to impress upon the municipal corporations using our simulations as well as the laboratory studies, how quickly this can build up floods. You know, it is not just an one-off event. Because these are clogged, everything upstream of that, they start clogging. They start overflowing. And therefore, where you were not expecting floods, because that watershed may not be receiving very high intensity rainfall, but because downstream gets clogged, all of that water starts getting flooded upstream of that. And this is what we show, not only through our simulations, but also through laboratory setups. Then we want to also impress upon the decision makers on the need for high resolution data. And typically, you know, if you go into that Aster type of DEMs, that is the digital elevation maps, you get about 30 meters by 30 meters elevation data. And that is highly inadequate for urban areas. In urban areas, as you can imagine, the ground levels are highly undulating. The land use pattern is very heterogeneous. And therefore, we need to capture this data at a very high resolution. So what we did as an experiment is that we used the LIDAR survey. We developed the LIDAR survey, light detection and ranging, and developed the terrain maps at 0.2 meter resolution. As you can see, you can almost distinguish between the leaves of trees here. That level of high resolution data we captured and then run our models. So on one side, you have high resolution rainfall data. And then on the other side, you also have water level sensors. This is for our experimental watershed in the campus, but you also have at several locations. So this is a sensor. So this sensor will capture how much water is flowing into. We have created an artificial lake here inside the campus where we are. We can afford to do that because we have a large free area. But in the city, perhaps this can be difficult. So this will capture. So we get a hydrograph here, actual rate of flow into the lake. And then we have identified the watershed and we identify the land use pattern at very high resolution. So these are some structural details. Because this is a engineering talk, I thought I'll give you some structural details. And so this we have done at several locations in the city. About 40 now we have installed, thanks to KSNDMC and BBMP, we have installed 40 such ranges. Now, just a matter of curiosity for the students here, I talked about the LIDAR. Now, LIDAR can be, LIDAR sensors can be mounted on a vehicle like this, and it can be taken along the road. But when areas are large, for example, if you are looking at Bangalore city entirely, etc., then you need heli-borne sensors. So typically they do it through helicopters. But we did it through a mobile vehicle mounted sensors. And this sensor scans about 200 meters by 200 meters and produces a very high resolution terrain data. Then because we had in IIC, we also had bushy areas and wooded areas, etc. There we had to do calibration of this through total station survey and so on. So all of this has been done. So imagine that this kind of data is available. You have good modeling technique. You have good estimation techniques of the rainfall. Then you can generate flood vulnerability as well as flood inundation maps. So typically what we do is we generate several flood scenarios for various rainfall intensities. You pick up from IDF relationships, and then you have a very high resolution maps. And there are several modeling techniques that are available now. INP PINS is what we did along with our Imperial College friends. And then you also have the building maps, you have the drainage maps, and you will generate DSM. This is a digital surface map, or a DEM, plus objects on the ground. Now, remember I talked about 0.2 meter DTMs or terrain maps. But because we are talking about larger watersheds, we did not have that data. So we have 2 meter resolution. So 2 meter contour intervals, actually, that is what we use. And then, from global data sets, remember, this is necessarily for the young researchers and students, that now global data sets are extremely reliable. And they can be calibrated with some ground observations and so on. So we use ASTER plus NASA data, and then bring it down to our Bangalore city level, and then see with some ground level observations, we check for the accuracy and so on. So you have on one side a complete terrain data, complete with the building maps, complete with drainage systems, etc. And on the other side, you have the rainfall intensities, and you have good hydrologic models, which convert the rainfall intensities into hydrographs. And using that, we should be able to generate flood inundation maps. This you could have seen better in the animation, but I'm not sure whether you can see it in PDF. So we create this DSM. Then we also have the stormwater drainage network. This stormwater drainage is given by BBMP, our municipal corporation, and this TRG network. This is data is given by KSNDMC. So we are rich in data, and therefore we should be able to show what can be done with all of this data. So then we start looking at 10-year, 15 minutes duration captured every 10 minutes. Now, this I wanted to show on animation so that you can appreciate, but unfortunately it is not to be. So 10 minutes, what kind of flooding happens? In this scale, it is very difficult to see. And that is why, you can appreciate on the animation. So 20 minutes, what happens? 30 minutes, what happens, etc. So how the flooding increases when this kind of rainfall duration. Remember here, I keep on emphasizing on this, especially for the hydrology students. It is a frequency of 10 years, which means that once in about 10 years, you may expect this kind of intensity. And this is 15 minutes duration, because the time of concentration of those watersheds will be of this 15 minutes. And therefore, we need to pick up from the IDF relationship a 15 minute duration rainfall intensity. Then we do the same thing again, you know, this was meant for animation. So we do the same thing and show all along the stream. This is a major network where all the overflows will occur and then how it spreads. One is what is happening in the channel itself. And another is once it overflows, how it spreads. That will depend on the land use as well as the DEM, that is the digital elevation maps of the surrounding area. Now, all of these we have to do it together so as to produce the flood inundation maps. And this is again, I have shown it for one of the valleys. And at 60 minutes, that means how it grows with respect to time is what you can see here. And these are the elevation data that is shown here. Of course, at this scale, it may appear very small. For example, compared to 10 minutes, 60 minutes, you may think that it's only a little bit spread. But these are to be scaled up. And you can see that all that surrounding area starts getting flooded. And not only the aerial extent, but also the flood inundation itself. Now, this is again animation, which will not work in the PDF. So this will show exactly how it grows. Now, how we have been able to do all of this is integrating several models, visualization techniques, and GIS package. Typically, I have used the ArcGIS here. And for using ArcGIS, SWMM coupling will be difficult. So we use what is called as a PCSWMM, PCSWMM, which is a commercial software. And commercial software linked with ArcInfo is what we have done. Now, this is similar result. Where we look at the buildings and how the water flows here and so on. This is all for planning purposes to understand with increasing intensities, with the type of development we have done, what kind of flood inundation may happen. For example, here we are showing, you take 10-year return period, 15 minutes duration, the maximum depth of flood can be 4 meters. But if you take the same thing 50 years without any other changes, it can go up to 7 meters. And remember, as I showed earlier, what was because the frequencies are increasing. So what is 50 years now, as per the historical data, may in fact become 10 years, which means that every 10 years we may get a 7 meters depth. That is the idea there. So this is an analysis that we can do using all our hydrologic models. Now, another important just demonstration. So these are the buildings. Remember, we are not so much interested in the height of the building and so on. Just look at the plinth area and the plan. And then we should be able to show how the water flows and where it gets stuck because of the obstructions and so on. And that is what we do through our models and animation. And this is how we show for a particular time how the flooding will occur. This is again is a combination of hydrologic models as well as the terrain data. Now this will not work now. Here I wanted to show how the water flows actually. If these are the buildings, then how the water will flow, and once the rainfall stops, how it withdraws. After my talk, if there is time, I'll show you those animations. Now this also you should have seen. Now these are, you know, on one side we cannot afford to stop development. Development has to keep on happening. But on the other side, we have to create opportunity for the water to be absorbed and if possible, recharge the groundwater. Now, because the flood discharges are extremely fast and the recharge process is extremely slow, we must devise material which will absorb the water at the same rate as it is coming. And also do it at such locations where you have good geologic formations which will absorb the water rapidly. If you can identify these in cities, then it will be ideal. But you know, this kind of material you can put in large parking areas, basements, etc., where the water will be just absorbed as it is coming. This is just a demonstration, but you can imagine this is a high intensity rainfall. It is falling. As it falls, so it goes down. As it falls, so it goes down. Like that, you can develop materials. So in essence, then, we need to appreciate the fact that the rainfall intensities are increasing, and the development on the ground, especially over the last about 10 years, 15 years in the country, a very rapid urbanization has taken place with very little attention to the stormwater drainage. And therefore, there must be some implementable actions that we need to look at. One is obvious that we need to look at efficiently working stormwater drainage system, including all engineering components. Such as at several places we may need pumping. For example, the Guwahati stormwater drainage does a huge pumping. And even in Bombay, we had done a project in which that ONGC campus, we had to fall recourse to pumping because there is no scope for gravity draining there. Then you must create storages, abutments, etc. With all of these must be efficiently working, which means that there must be a good maintenance and any physical obstructions should be avoided. Then, as many of these cities are looking at the city development plans, CDPs, they must now start looking at well-planned urban development with adequate space for natural drainage, lakes, water bodies, gardens and lawns, wetlands, etc., leaving out low-lying areas as undeveloped. So, in fact, if you have a good low-lying area, you can very easily develop a nice tank or a nice lake, make it a good breathing space for the citizens and so on. Then roads and parking lots with pervious material, as I showed, you can develop pervious material so that you can absorb the water as it falls. Then high density rain gauge network. This is extremely important, and Bangalore has been fortunate because Bangalore City has developed this thanks to KSNDMC and BBMP. These will be necessary to develop good forecasting tools to issue flood alerts because there is a huge spatial distribution of high intensity rainfall. Then we must also start looking at low impact development methods, and I'll show you some of the examples. For example, rainwater harvesting, catchment treatment, etc., which will reduce the discharges that are coming into stormwater drains. Now the question is that on one side rainfall intensities are increasing, which means that the discharges that are produced on the ground are increasing. But there is no scope for us to enhance the stormwater drainage system because of non-availability of the land. So on one side we are increasing the discharge, but on the other side, you do not have the capacity to convey it. Then what is the question that we need to address? The question that we need to address is, for the same intensity of rainfall, can we reduce the discharges that are coming into the stormwater drains? Which means that we must have several low impact development measures put in place at several locations. Then we must start looking at urban water cycle as a whole. Not necessarily, and this is the point that Professor V.P. Singh also touched upon, that you need to look at integrated water management in urban areas where the stormwater drainage is an integral part of the entire urban water cycle. In fact, in Bangalore City, thanks to Biome and necessarily Biome, which is an NGO, and you must have heard of Mr. Vishwanath's name, even in the stormwater drain itself, they put some recharge wells so that as the water is flowing in the stormwater drain, there is an opportunity for us to recharge the groundwater. Then rapid response mechanisms developed for individual cities to take actions and so on. These are all obvious. Okay, in Bangalore City, what we have done, I'll just take a maximum of 10 more minutes now. In Bangalore City, what we have done is we have collected the geologic maps. And we understand from our geology friends that there are formulations which are almost like blotting papers. As the water falls, they just suck the water and just absorb the water. And such places we can identify, we look at the recharge capacities and most of these centralized zones will have very poor recharge capacities because the groundwater levels can be quite shallow there because of the leakages from wastewater systems and so on, even water distribution systems and so on. Then we look at several low impact development measures. For example, if there is a space, can we put green roofs, bioretention walls, infiltration tank, rain barrel, rain garden, etc., permeable pavement, vegetative swales, and so on. All of these details are available in SWMM manual, also in my talk PPT. So we ask the question, if we put any of these LIDs, let's say we identify the space where maybe bioretention is feasible, rain barrel is feasible, etc. We identify open spaces that are available and then start playing with those and putting some low impact development regions, measures there. And then show for a combination of low impact development, how much of reduction in the extent of flooding we can achieve. For example, the maximum depth itself may come down because of these, but what is more important is in the aerial extent, we can achieve about 29% of reduction in the aerial extent of flooding by achieving many combinations. For example, here we may achieve up to 38%. Now, these kind of questions can be answered. And then Bangalore was known to be a city of lakes earlier, but many cities, many lakes are now depleting. So we show through this the effect of depletion of lakes. And again, we do similar exercise, look at high intensity rainfall and with the current data available on lakes, how the flood inundation will be. Then if you start reducing the lakes at certain measures, at certain levels, then what happens to the maximum depth? And suppose you encroach upon all the lakes, then what happens to the flood depth as well as the flood inundation? Then all of this needs to be put to decision making. And this we have done, I'm sure Shubha in her talk will touch upon this. We have done a significant improvement in this, starting with the high intensity rainfall. As I said, we also pick up forecasts and now we are developing the forecast, communicate this on real time. And then we also have the water level sensors. From the water level sensors, we know what is happening at which locations. And we have an alert decision making system. This is on the KSNDMC server. I'm sure Shubha will talk more details on this. So right now we have developed a mobile app, and you can download that mobile app from the Google Play Store, which shows on real time how the rainfall is getting spread, how the rainfall is distributed across the city, as well as how the water levels are changing. Now, this is just for young researchers. Apart from what we do on engineering side, you also need to do on science side. There must be a way by which you can forecast the high resolution rainfall. So we set up the WRF model. This is weather research forecasting model. This is a numerical weather prediction model for the Bangalore city. We pick up the boundary conditions from a larger domain. And as the boundary conditions change, you should be able to change your rainfall forecast. And we have been quite successful in doing that. The last point that I would like to touch upon is exactly the last point that Professor VP Singh also touched upon, that we need to look at the urban flooding as a integrated urban water management component. We should not be looking at stormwater management as an individual independent entity by itself. Everything about urban water is interconnected, and we must look at water resource management, you should look at water supply, wastewater treatment, and then water allocation. And all of this will require a good capacity building and partnership of stakeholders, solving policy disputes, and so on. Now, with that, I'll give you some two examples. You can just have a look at this. We developed, this was through PSA, that is Principal Scientific Advisor's Office to Prime Minister. When Chennai floods, IIT Bombay, my student Professor Subimal Ghosh led this multi-institute team. We have developed local levels, forecast rainfall from 6 hours to 72 hours. Then you look at the drainage conditions. You also look at the moisture conditions, and then you develop a expert system for real time operation. And this has been made available to the Ministry of Earth Science. This is, the summary of this has been published in Current Science. Those who are interested can go into this. Now, what we are doing is, all of this effort that we have put over the last about 6 years, we have now taken up another project. This is on National Supercomputing Mission. This project is led by CDAC, but the hydrology component is being done by us, where our aim is to transfer all of this knowledge and put it on a supercomputing platform where the users can simply log into that supercomputing platform and then use these models, use this knowledge for their purpose. So we will also generate adequate number of manuals, help files, data files. You know, there are global data sets which you can download for your region. So all of this will be done. Now, this is hardly about 8 months into this project, and we have done quite a bit of work. And this, finally, we want to make sure that any city in this country should be able to use this. Science to society is our aim there. Now, remember, urban water is only one component. We are also addressing the air pollution through our partnership with CDAC. Similarly, the numerical weather prediction that I showed, this will be done by IIT Bhubaneswar. Banaras and Ahmedabad, and one more city, Pune. So these are the five cities that we have taken. So all these five cities' input as well as output will be made available, and also the modeling framework will be available. Now, for the researchers in these areas, there are some good science issues that you need to be aware of. First of all, we need to address the question, are the intensities of urban rainfall in fact increasing? If that's a question, then we should look at the likely changes in the IDF relationships, where we have to address scale issues and uncertainties. Then high resolution data generation and hydrologic modeling is important. Then we must also look at the combined effect of climate change and land use on extreme precipitation. So with that, I'll stop here. I'm sorry that the PPT did not work, but luckily at least this much could work. So thank you all very much for your attention. I hope you heard all of that I was talking about, and I'll be open to questions. And especially I would like to thank again Professor Prasad, as well as Dr. Jyoti Prasad, and the entire GB Pant University. So thank you all very much. I am open to questions if there is time. Otherwise, you can put it on the chat. Thank you.
Okay. Let's have just two or three questions only. Yeah. Anyone wants to have any queries? You can switch on your video, and you can switch on your audio and video. You can directly ask. You can directly interact by switching on your audio and video, please. Introduce yourself first. Yes, please. Any queries? Any thing?
Or they can put it in the chat window. I can answer it later. But I hope this PDF was visible, because many of them are saying that it was not in the full mode. PDF was visible, Professor Prasad?
No, it was visible. Only thing is, maybe those who are on mobile, they might have faced some problem. Yeah, any queries, please?
Excuse me, sir.
Dr. Rajesh Ji.
Yeah. Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please, go ahead.
Yeah, myself, Aarti. I'm a research scholar from SVNIT Surat.
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Sir, actually, you have shown that downscaling and desegregation, and after dynamic downscaling, we went for the block level or city level. But sir, you have mentioned that ensemble of the SIMIF-5 models. I want to ask you, what if basin level study is carried out and some base GCM-5 or 6 GCMs are available? Instead of going 30 to 35 GCM ensembles, is it possible to carry out the study using 4 to 5 GCM for that basin and the city from that basin?
Yeah, excellent question. Thank you very much. It is possible, and you have a good point. So there are ways of ranking the GCMs. There is no point in doing 30 or 50 GCMs, etc. It is very time consuming. So there are papers available from Nagesh Kumar's group. You can see how do you rank the GCMs for the particular application. So there are fuzzy ranking and so on. You imagine that you want to apply it for a certain river basin, let us say. Now, using the historical data, and there are what are called as the 20th century runs available for these models. So you use these GCMs and then look at how best they are able to produce the historical data. If you have adequate 30 to 40 years data, then based on how well they are able to produce, you can rank them. That is one way of doing it. And therefore, you can bring down the number of GCMs from 5 to 6. So you must refer to ranking of GCMs. You can just Google, you will get several publications on that. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Mr. Pradeep Kumar Vadulooru, you can directly put a query. Okay, any others? If he is not there. Yes, sir. Dr. R.K. Prasad, please.
Yeah, should I answer that? I have a query regarding preparation.
Dr. R.K. Prasad, directly.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for your very nice, interesting lecture. I have a query related to IDF curve, sir. We want to prepare IDF curve for a city which is where the data is very rarely available. Only IMD data or that too on monthly basis is available. So how to get the IDF curve unless we get a long record of the data or on hourly basis or daily basis?
Yes, this is a very common problem, especially in our country, and it is rather unfortunate because urban flooding is becoming an extremely critical problem. And we seem to be doing only firefighting in most of the cities. So it is important for us to look at what is happening to high intensity, short duration rainfall. But that kind of data is not available in most of the cities. But IMD actually collects the data at very high resolution. It is only very difficult for ordinary mortals like you and me to get the data. But you must put effort to get the data because IMD has TRGs, that is telemetric rain gauges, where 15-minute data is available, is recorded, but they do not convert it into digital mode. So now that urban flooding is becoming important, in fact, even for Bangalore city, what we did is luckily because I was involved in that CDAC project where IMD is also a partner, for Bangalore city we could get 15 minutes data. But on the other side, I would like to mention that we have KSNDMC data which is available almost 2 minutes, 3 minutes, etc., but it is available for a shorter duration, let's say only 6 years, 8 years, etc. So you must use this high resolution data for Bangalore. I'm telling for Bangalore, what we did is use this high resolution data available at a shorter duration, but a very low resolution 1 or 2 station data available for a longer duration. Develop methodologies by which you can extend the KSNDMC data. That is what we have done in Bangalore. You will see it in publication later. But in places where you do not have data, it is necessary for you to get the high resolution data. Otherwise, without that, you won't be able to do. The only other way of doing it is hydrologic regionalization. So there are methods by which you can do the regionalization of extreme precipitation across the city, across the country, I'm sorry. And you can refer to our V.V. Srinivas work in IISc. They have done a lot of work on regionalization. So if you have absolutely no data, it becomes a prediction in engaged basins. So prediction in engaged basins, there are a large number of methodologies available. You can use those things. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
I am Oshin from IIT Roorkee. Sir, I have a question regarding the low. You have touched the concept of low impact development techniques, like you have told us about rain gardens or like that. So, sir, in our Indian conditions, is it really possible that we can implement these techniques like rain garden? Or you can give me some examples where we are using these techniques, because I have heard about a lot number of developed countries like Australia or US, they are already using these techniques. But we are just studying about these techniques. So can you please help?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. That was a nice question. In fact, you know, this is always a conflict, how we develop our cities. And the conventional way of developing is simply put buildings and roads and things like that without much attention to the flooding situation. Even in CDPs, that is the city development plans, we were surprised that stormwater drainage was not a component at all, in spite of getting so many floods. But now, because of necessity, the government is also becoming sensitized on this. So to answer your specific question, you know, for example, you take simple rainwater harvesting type of things. You know, the rainwater harvesting is slightly oversold also, but you know, in terms of the impact or the effects on the urban floods, rainwater harvesting can play a major role. Now, rainwater harvesting does not necessarily mean that you collect the water on your roofs and things like that. You can have small ponds. If you have a gated community, you can have a small pond and divert all of your rainfall into that particular pond. Similarly, what we call as zero discharge, you know, much similar to your zero liquid discharge of the industries. We also now talk about zero discharge from the campuses, large areas and so on, where whatever falls there, you must be able to hold back. And all these methods that I showed. Campus, we have done several things, of course, because we have the luxury of large open areas and all. But even if you do not have large open areas, you know, have recharge wells and so on. So if you ask me where it has been implemented, I would have to stick my neck out and say nowhere it has been implemented. But in the country. But in the country, it is necessary to start looking at these options and then show how they can reduce the flooding. You know, at this stage, I'm sorry that I cannot give you any more information because it's simply not available in the country. But as you rightly said, you know, other countries have done it very successfully. And we should at least emulate, if not have any original solutions of that. So I think the yeah, over to you. I hope I addressed your question, Oshin.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So there are some other questions, Archana Kumar. Yeah. On the chat, what do you want to do, Shiv Prasad?
You can answer it, sir, directly.
Okay, then there is first question, then IDF I answered. Bioremediation can curb the urban flood and urban pollution. Now, this is a simple, you know, biological treatment of the watersheds. Maybe I'll show you this. Let me take 1 minute to just tell me if you can see this. Are you able to see this? Are you able to see this, please?
Yes, sir.
So these are the bioretention areas. So these use soil and plant-based filtration devices that remove pollutants through a variety of, you know, all these are classical things. You can just, you know, either Google or if you have SWMM models, you have the details on that. So these are some low impact development, vegetative swales, infiltration trench, and so on. So I can share these also with you. Now the next question is, I think Prasad, I am not overshooting my time, right? I'll just answer one more.
Last 5 minutes.
Yeah. So are there any guidelines for urban management in smart city projects in India? Okay. There is a NDMA guideline for urban stormwater drainage, urban flooding. You can just look up NDMA. This is slightly old now, 2010 or something. We were all involved in that. So that gives you a very good guideline on integrated approach for urban floods. Now, smart city projects, these are done independently, individually, I would say. For example, for Pune city, we are involved. For Bangalore city, we are involved. These have to be done separately, individually, because every city has its own unique problems. For example, some of them may be coastal cities. Some of them may have rivers flowing in them. Some of them may be high-level cities such as Bangalore and so on. So inland cities, and then Hyderabad city, which has its own lakes and things like that. So every city has a characteristic problem. So using a broad guideline that is given by NDMA, you need to start with this. You can just Google NDMA urban flood guideline. You will get that. Okay.
Sir, thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your
first
enlightening
maybe
lecture.
Let me just close this.
Faculty members, the participants, as well as research scholars, they have got a lot of information from you. And if they need anything additional, I think they can give the mail to you in case any sort of interested to know about certain things, they may contact you, sir.
Yes, most welcome. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And
just one thing.
Thank you, sir.
I will thank all of you, especially Professor Prasad and Jyoti Prasad, and the participants for wonderful discussion. Professor Prasad, my only request is the file that I sent is PPT. So please do not use that. I can share the PDF with participants.
No,
I can share the PDF.
No, PPT has not been received.
Okay.
Just make PDF.
Because you know there are some projects which are still going on, that CDAC project.
No.
Otherwise I'll be happy to share anything with the participants.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can whatever that you want to share, you just make it a PDF file and you can just
okay. I'll share the PDF file after editing. Okay.
Sure.
Okay. Okay, thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.